Thanks for joining us for Ruth Institute's podcast. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org. We seek to change the narrative around marriage and family to create a cultural climate favorable to lifelong married love. We also seek to promote recovery and healing from the wounds of the sexual revolution and share our stories with the next generation. I encourage you to visit our website, where you can sign up for our free e-newsletter and receive more information on what we're doing around the country and how you can be involved. Dr. J addresses law students participating in the Alliance Defending Freedom's Blackstone Legal Fellowship. In this part of her talk, her topic is the sexual revolution and its victims.
Before I start, I want to share with you just a couple of resources that we have available at the Ruth Institute website that you can get. One is we have a tips book, 101 Tips for a Happier Marriage, 101 Tips for Marrying the Right Person. These are available at our website. We try to produce things to try to keep the family together, right? And part of that is picking out the right person in the first place. Secondly, a couple of books have come out that I've been involved with that I want to share with you. One is this special report from the Ruth Institute called Marriage and Equality, How Natural Marriage Upholds the Ideal of Equality for Children. One of my colleagues wrote this, and it really deals with, and I'm going to deal with some aspects of it in my talk here, but I just wanted you to be aware that this publication exists and that you can acquire it if you want to. And then finally, another thing that just recently came out, this is a book called Primal Loss, The Now Adult Children of Divorce Speak, edited by Layla Miller, okay? And this book is just what it says. She she got people to write the answers to a bunch of questions, and she compiled it into this book of, you know, what was it like for you, basically, giving adults the opportunity to talk about what it was like. This is a very raw book. There's a lot of pain in this book. But if this applies to you or anyone you know, I think this is going to be a very powerful and helpful resource for adult children of divorce and all the different things that they have to deal with. I wrote the foreword to this book, just so you know. And the foreword to this book has been published on Clash Daily, and it has been shared, last time I looked, 1,500 times it's been shared. So obviously a lot of people care about the impact of divorce on adult children. So what I'm going to do in this last hour is we'll talk about the sexual revolution, and we'll talk about a little bit about what we can do about all this, because the further we go into this, the more you can see that we've got a mess on our hands here. So let me talk to you about the sexual revolution and how I would define it. I'm so sorry that that ran off the screen. I don't know how that happened. Okay, there are three basic points to the sexual revolution. That a good and decent society should do the following three things. A good and decent society should separate sex from babies, should do everything possible to separate sex from babies. I call this the contraceptive ideology. Secondly, a good and decent society should do everything possible to separate both sex and babies from marriage. Namely, there's no necessary presumption that children be born into marriage. There's no necessary presumption that sex takes place exclusively within marriage. I call this the divorce ideology. And then the final point, the third point, is that a good and decent society should wipe out all differences between men and women, except for those things which the individuals explicitly choose to embrace on their own by themselves. And I call this the gender ideology. Now, before we say anything else, what I want you to notice, by the way, do you recognize these ideas? You recognize these concepts? You know, that sex, babies, marriage are all in separate boxes, right? Okay. Sometimes people will say, we should not be imposing morality on people. And you Christians should get out of the public square because you're just trying to impose your morality on people. What I want you to notice, first of all, is that there is an implied morality built into this ideology. Every one of these ideologies has a morality, a moral code, an idea of right and wrong built into it. All right? And so don't let people buffalo you with this idea that you're imposing morality on people and they're not somehow. There's a morality involved here. So let's take these three parts and talk about them a little bit. Let's talk first of all about the contraceptive ideology. Now, before I say anything here, I already outed myself in the last lecture, so you know that I'm a Roman Catholic. I know from coming to Blackstone a lot of years, you guys have probably already been quarreling about contraception among yourselves. Am I right? Has that happened? No? Okay, never mind. I'm at the wrong place. Okay. Well, here's all I want to say about it. I am not here to give you theological arguments or talk you into some different theology than whatever you have about this. I'm not even here to tell you to throw away your pills or your condoms or whatever you might have. That's not what this is about. What I'm here to do is to take a sober-minded look at the impact of the contraceptive ideology on society. Okay? And you guys can argue about the rest of the stuff tonight or whatever. Okay? Because I know that'll happen. All right. So let's talk a bit about this. Now, the idea of the contraceptive ideology is that we're separating sex from babies. And part of where we're headed is, of course, that UN goal, okay? That UN goal that everybody's entitled to a safe and satisfying sex life, that whole thing. And what we're saying is that every person who's old enough to give consent is entitled to unlimited sexual activity. All right, that's the end game of this ideology. That's where it's headed. But in order to say that a good and decent society should separate sex from babies, there are a couple of things that you have to do also. Things that have, that are kind of in the background that are not really talked about, right? But you have to be able to say that we're going to have contraception that works perfectly and that has no cost associated with it. Because you have to believe, somehow in your mind, you have to believe that the sexual act has been safely sterilized. You see what I mean? That it doesn't make any sense to say we're going to separate sex from babies unless you believe that's possible. Okay, now what I want to say to you is that it's possible in any particular case to separate sex from babies, but to build a whole society around the idea that the whole society can separate sex from babies, that's a bigger order, that's a taller order. And I'm going to argue that that's really not possible to do that, and that's what we're in fact trying to do. So contraception has to be available, and if the contraception fails, it has to be that you have to have abortion as a backup plan, available as a backup plan, okay? Now, free doesn't simply mean that it's legal, sitting on the shelf, and that anybody can take advantage of it if they want to. Anybody can go to the drugstore and buy condoms. People can get their doctors to prescribe birth control pills or what have you. That's not the contraceptive ideology. How do I know that? Because that has never been enough for the true radicals. It has never been enough for it to just be legally available and people can do what they want with it. That has never been enough for them. They have always had an aspect of promoting it, pushing it, promoting it, making it freer and freer, cheaper and cheaper. And what do I mean by free? It means that you have to reduce all the costs and inconveniences associated with it. Because if you don't do that, then you may come to the conclusion that, you know, I get that I'm entitled to have sex without babies, but the risk of using contraception is sufficient to me that I don't want to take the risk, so I'm going to not use contraception and not have sex, because that's my choice, that's my decision. Probably a lot of you have made that choice, right? But that's not good enough for the ideology. So they have to say that there's no risk or harm associated either with contraception or abortion. In order to create a society where sex and babies are separated, you have to be able to say that anybody can use these methods and have no risk of anything associated with it. So there are now well-documented risks associated with abortion, well-documented health risks associated with contraception, and you never hear about them unless you subscribe to some wild, crazy, Christian right-wing wacko site like I do. And like I write for all the time, right? But in the mainstream media, you don't hear about this kind of stuff. You don't hear that between 10 and 30% of women who have an abortion have serious regrets about it and are traumatized by it, okay? So if you knew that, now let's say you're a woman, you're going for an abortion, and the doctor, let's say this was just any other medical procedure. And the doctor says to you, oh, you would like to have an abortion. Do you have a family history of depression? Yes, I do have a family history of depression. In fact, I myself have a personal history of depression. The doctor should say to you, gosh, you're at risk for feeling suicidal. You're at risk for being seriously depressed after your abortion. Abortion is contraindicated for you. I cannot recommend in good conscience that you have an abortion. You should solve your problems some other way. Does any abortion clinic anywhere in the United States talk to anybody like that?
No.
They do not. After 40 years of Roe v. Wade, nobody's thought of that? No, of course they've thought of it, but they discard it. They dismiss it because it interrupts the flow of the narrative, which says there's no cost, you see? So there's a whole list of things I could go into like that, 20-year-olds dying of strokes because of their contraception that they're on, or their hormonal contraception, and so on. There's a whole list of these risks that are systematically downplayed in the public media. That's part of the contraceptive ideology at work, all right? Because it's got to be free. Got to be not only accessible, but free, no cost. I'm going to mention another Catholic pope here. This is Pope Paul VI. Those of you who are Catholic and know some of the controversies that have taken place over contraception within the Catholic Church may know that Pope Paul VI was the one who wrote the encyclical Humanae Vitae, reaffirming the Catholic Church's condemnation of artificial birth control. He predicted all of these problems that would take place as a result of contraception being widely available. This was in 1968. He predicted all of these things. And he has turned out to be completely correct. He has turned out in every particular to be correct about what he forecast based in 1968. But the other thing I want to mention to all of you is that the Catholic Church, this is often thought of as a Catholic issue, but you need to know, and maybe some of you do know, that historically all the Christian churches held this very same position. Historically all the Christian churches believed that contraception was against the divine law, was against the natural law. So Luther was against it, Calvin was against it. It was only in 1930 at the Lambeth Convention where the Anglican Church said that married couples for serious reasons could use contraception. It would be morally licit for them to do so. Now look at that. Married couples for serious reason could use it. Anglican Church. That is the time, that's the first time that a Protestant denomination ever said that it was okay. All right, so just so you know, this is everybody's tradition once you go back further than 1930. So a lot of Catholics find this meme funny. I told you so. Anyway. All right, so another aspect of the contraceptive ideology is the whole idea of infidelity. Okay, I don't know if you're familiar with the Ashley Madison website. This is basically an online internet dating service for people who are married. It's life is short, have an affair. I mean, literally, that's what they say. I'm glad you kids don't know what this is. Some of you know what it is. Anyway, they boast that they have 41 million members online of people trying to find somebody who will have sex with them that they're not married to. This kind of behavior would be unthinkable if you didn't believe that you could safely contracept your sex, right? If you didn't think contraception was safe, if you didn't think abortion was available as a backup plan and had no risk attached to it, you wouldn't even conceive of doing such a thing as this, and you certainly would not have 41 million members involved. Okay, so second point of the sexual revolution, separate both sex and babies from marriage, and I call this the divorce ideology, all right? And so I'd like to explain that by dealing with alternative family forms from the child's perspective. Okay, last time we ended with that slide showing from the child's perspective. Want to go into that a little bit more deeply. It's well documented that children of divorce and children of single parents are at risk for a whole variety of problems, and I gather that some of your earlier speakers this week have mentioned that to you in some form or another. And when we talk about, we at the Ruth Institute, when we talk about alternative family forms and we talk about the divorce ideology, we include all of these things as ways of the family breaking down or family breakdown, whether it's divorce, parents who were never married in the first place, cohabiting parents, remarried or other step-parenting situations, and then finally anonymous sperm donors. As I mentioned, a lot of research has been done showing that children are at risk for a whole variety of negative outcomes if their parents are not continuously married to each other. I want to pause and give you just an idea of some of why that might be. Okay? What's behind that? I think that it's for the following reason, that as a child, each of your parents, they're half of who you are. You know, your dad's half of who you are, your mom's half of who you are. And all too often what will happen is parents will decide they're going to divorce, and here's the sort of thing that they'll say. And this is what our culture tells people to say. They'll say, "We still love you, honey, but we just don't love each other anymore." Okay, I don't know if any of you have ever heard that or know anybody who's had that said to them. The problem with that is it's impossible. Those two things are contradictory. I still love you, but I don't love half of who you are, namely your dad, or namely your mom. I'm rejecting half of who you are, but I still love you, right? So there's a contradiction that you're asking the child to make sense of. And, you know, of course, in their little mind, it's not rational in the first place, but in their little mind that's not really very rational in the first place, they can't really make sense of it very well. And so they have this kind of feeling that they're trying to make sense of something that isn't really working and that can't be made to work. Now, I am sure in this room, I am sure that some of you have had some of these structural injustices take place to you. In a room this size of people your age, 100% certainty, there are people here who have experienced the divorce or separation of their parents in some form or fashion. And so what I want to say to you is it was not your fault. Because a lot of times little kids think it is their fault. And I want to affirm for you that if it was hard for you, that it's okay that it was hard for you. You're entitled for it to be hard for you. All right? Here are some of the things that children of divorce, particularly remarried, when their parents remarry, some of the things that children have to deal with and are expected to deal with routinely. The child is asked to move from one house to the next on a regular basis, a fate that very few adults would willingly put up with, right? But we accept that as routine, that when there's a divorce, it's the child who changes locations every other weekend or whatever it is. It's the child who doesn't know where their homework is. When a parent remarries, when one of the parents remarries or has a new relationship, maybe it's not a marital relationship, the child is supposed to be okay with it. Child is supposed to be okay going to their dad's house and seeing their dad in bed with somebody that's not their mom. That's supposed to be okay. The child isn't supposed to feel anything about that. When they go to their mom's house and there's a picture of their mom and her new husband and their kids that they had together, and that whole family group is hanging on the wall in a picture, and there's no picture of you with your mom and your dad. There's no picture like that of your family. That's supposed to be okay. You go to your dad's house, same thing. There'll be your dad and his new wife and their kids they had together. His relatives will be on the wall. Her relatives will be on the wall. But there's no pictures like that of you. There's a fundamental inequality in the way the children of the first marriage are treated and the children of the current marriage are treated. A fundamental inequality in how the kids are treated. So what I want to say to you is I think the reason the kids have so many problems, right, the reason all these issues come up is because we're asking kids to deal with a situation that is intrinsically stressful. And all too often, we take the kids for therapy, we put the kids on medication, and we don't realize that there's something fundamentally wrong with the situation. It's not the kid. Honestly, it's not the kid. And that's what we deal with in this book, in this little report. My colleague, Jennifer Johnson, deals with that in this book. Now, let's take a quick look, if we can, at this pamphlet. Look at this chart that we've created. This chart has a whole list of people, groups of people who have been harmed in some way or another by the sexual revolution. All right? So at the very top of the list, children of divorce, children of unmarried parents. And then you read across the list, it describes who they are, what it is. And then at the far side of the brochure, what you see is this what you were told? At the very top of the list, kids are resilient. Kids are resilient. That's what we tell ourselves when we justify a separation between the parents that we can't otherwise justify. Now, here's what I want to say, because I know from experience that some of you who've been in this situation are protective of your parents. I know that. And you don't want me saying your parents are bad people. Your parents aren't bad people. I mean, maybe some of them are, but no, I'm not going to say that, okay? Everybody in society has been told kids are resilient and it's all okay. And if it doesn't work out, there's something peculiar about your family. Because really, this can be made to work. It's really all okay. But look at this chart. There are 12 different groups of survivors of the sexual revolution, and you can study it more later, all the way down to the hookup culture, refugees from the hookup culture, and people who have experienced bad effects from their hookups or their contraception or whatever. And associated with all 12 of these categories, there are three or four socially sanctioned lies that are told. That last column, is this what you were told? Let me translate that last column. That last column is full of lies. But those are lies that are culturally told again and again and again. Kids have no feelings at all about their parents changing partners. Kids have, people, down you look at the hookup culture people. The hookup culture people. People have no jealousy whatsoever if their boyfriend or girlfriend goes off and has sex with someone else. We're all supposed to be cool with that. We're not all cool with that. These are all lies. So here's the point. People are making decisions on the basis of a culture that is filled with falsehood. A lot of good people are making big mistakes. It's not all their fault. That's what I want to say. Even if something happened in your family that was seriously unjust and wrong and shouldn't have happened, we have to kind of be gentle with each other because people are acting on the basis of a lot of false information. People are giving up perfectly good marriages because they think their kids will be fine. They think their kids will be better off if we just separate. Everything will be fine, right? And so that's what's happening with people. The next slide here is showing some of the risk factors that children of divorce experience. I'm not going to go through this too much, but you can see some of these things probably were mentioned to you in earlier talks. All I want to do is to say that we have brochures on these topics too. That chart, this chart that I have up here with all these different things, which I believe are the underlying cause of them all is the disruption of relationships, as I mentioned. You can get that information on this brochure, Children and Divorce, and we have a comparable brochure on children and same-sex parenting. I now want to turn to the issue of donor-conceived persons. And again, in a room this size of people of your generation, there are undoubtedly people in this room who have probably, there's somebody here who's been conceived through some kind of either artificial means or maybe third-party reproduction. When I say third-party reproduction, donor conception, what I mean is anonymous sperm donor, anonymous egg donor, okay, and that's the means of conception. So the first thing I want to say to you, if that's your situation, and what I want you to have in your hearts as you deal with other people or talk to other people about this issue, you must never regret the child. Okay, you must never regret the child. There is nothing wrong with the child who is brought into being in this way, all right? That's the very first thing we have to say. Every child was created by God. Every single child is brought into being by God. Goodness knows that lots of IVF procedures fail, right? A lot of them fail. In fact, I've never heard of anybody who got it on the first try, right? So every person who comes into being is brought into being as an act of love by God, no matter how messed up we might be as humans in our participation of the whole thing. So that's the first thing that I want you to be assured of, that I believe that, and I believe all of our churches teach that as well, all right? But here's the thing with the children of donor conception. They have issues, not all of them, but the ones who have it, it's a little bit like adoption, except it's like adoption on steroids. Not everybody has issues with it, but the ones who have issues really have issues. They want to know who they are. They want to know who they are. They don't know who they are. Sometimes they're angry about secrecy if they don't find out until they're 17 or something that my dad's not really my dad, right? There's a website called Anonymous Us, put together by a lady named Alana Newman, who is a big advocate for the rights of donor-conceived persons to know themselves and to know their identities and so on, to know their, she's opposed to donor anonymity. People write in and tell, Anonymous Us is where people can write in and tell their stories, what it was like. When people find out that they were donor conceived, it's like that, it's a moment they never forget, a visceral moment that they never forget. I always knew something was not quite right, but now I know, you know, and it's just, it's completely disorienting for them. So all of these issues are things that I think people have not really thought about very much. As we've kind of moved into the brave new world. And I know you've got Jennifer Law coming in a few days, and she'll talk with you even more about these issues. I want to just mention that the next to the last point there, concern about encountering half-siblings. Through my friend Alana, I've come to know a number of people in the donor-conceived community, and I've met one young man who found out who his donor was, and he found out that his father gave sperm, donated sperm, about once a month for 10 years while he was in medical school. Once a month for 10 years. And my friend believes, has reason to believe, that he has 500 half-siblings. I'll let that sink in. He eventually moved away from his town because he kept seeing people who looked strangely like himself. Okay, and that's something most people don't have to worry about. Right, so he moved from Kansas to Florida to get away from the possibility that he was going to run into a half-sibling in this way. And I just think we should say that nobody should have to worry about a thing like that, right? And this is like King Solomon with 1,000 concubines or whatever it is, you know? Except everybody knew that it was King Solomon and there was no secrecy, so on and so forth. Okay. So obviously, there are many points we could make about that. We actually also have a brochure about donor-conceived persons, too, so if you want to look that up online. Okay, so let's move on, though, to talk about the gender ideology and wiping out all the differences between men and women except those explicitly chosen by individuals. Now, years ago, when feminist movements first kicked in, I used to say, because I've always been a critic of certain kinds of feminism, I used to say, feminism believes that men and women are identical, except women are better. Right. And people used to laugh, you know. But now we've kind of moved on from that, because the original idea that was there was that the differences you see between men and women, they were all socially constructed. And so now we can go and personally reconstruct them. So society can, the goal was that society can reconstruct. If they were constructed in the first place, we can reconstruct them. So any differences you see between men and women, they're all suspect. They're socially constructed, they're probably unjust, and a good and decent society should wipe out all those differences, right? That was kind of the first phase of this whole intellectual process. But now it's to the point where it's not just that society should wipe out these differences, society can construct and reconstruct, but the individual can construct and reconstruct himself or herself. All right, and so that's what gives us the whole transgender phenomenon that we're dealing with. That I think a lot of people don't know how to deal with, don't know how to explain it, how to deal with it. What I want to point out to you is this is the decathlon winner from 1976. Okay, there shouldn't really be a question about whether the decathlon winner in 1976 was a man or a woman, right? But he wants to reconstruct himself, and so that's where we are. So a lot of times people will say, how did this transgender thing just come out of nowhere? You know, it's come on us so fast. Where did this come from? Why has it come on us so fast? And I would like to say that it didn't just come out of nowhere. It's been building for a long time. And I put up here some ideas, some specific things, where for a long time, everybody has been expected to kind of mentally degender themselves. Okay, we have been expected and taught to degender ourselves. And what I mean by that is to say, all differences between men and women are socially constructed, then I should be able to have a career on exactly the same terms as a man has a career. And oh, whoops, I'm 35 and I can't have a baby. Whoops, that doesn't apply to the man. Whoops, forgot about that, right? But I can tell you, I've lived it, lots of other people have lived it, that we are trying to do something that is gender neutral. We're trying to rebuild the society to make it gender neutral, and then every once in a while, some little thing will pop up like, whoa, wait a minute, maybe we aren't gender neutral after all. Maybe I actually am not a generic person. Maybe I'm a woman. Maybe my husband's not generic either. Maybe he's a man. Wow, that explains a lot. You know, and I can honestly say to you that the infertility experience was the first experience that we had as a couple where it was obvious to us that he was a man and I was a woman. I mean, that sounds like a stupid thing to say. We're both intelligent people. But, you know, that's how thorough this mental process is. If some of you young ladies would like to say or have ever had the experience that you wanted to say, what I want to do when I grow up is I want to be a mommy, and somebody told you not to say that, and you censor that, you learn to censor that. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Okay, and is that gone now? People can say that? Oh, good. I'm glad you girls can say that without fear. What's going on here? Am I reading this right? See, my limbic brain is trying to tune in, figure out what's going on here. Anyway, certainly many of us had this experience. I won't try to speak for you, but many of us have had this experience of feeling that we had to apologize for our desire to be moms. And that when we get ourselves into a situation where it's socially acceptable, it's a huge relief. Right? It's just a huge relief to be able to enter into that as a woman, as a mother, as not as a generic parent, but as a woman. One of the tensions that my husband and I had in parenthood and that we have observed other people having, particularly when the babies are little, we kind of want dad to be an assistant mom. I'm in charge here. You do what I tell you. Okay? And you're not doing it right, dear. Give me back the baby. You know, that kind of thing. Well, you know, maybe he wasn't doing it right, but he was doing it okay. He was doing it well enough, right? But we have this idea. that the father's role is simple. That everything is functional. That's what I'm trying to say. That everything is functional. You know, in other words, what mom does is diaper the baby, so therefore dad can diaper the baby too. What mom does is feed the baby, so therefore dad can feed the baby too. But this misunderstands the ontological reality of being a woman and being a man and how you interact with your own offspring. Okay, I'm going to give you some examples. I'm going to give you some cute examples, and you'll laugh. But if you try this at your law school, I don't recommend that you bring this up at your law school because people will say that's sexist. Right? Won't they say that? Okay, so here's one, right? That when you have that what do dads do with babies? They bounce them on their knees and then they throw them up in the air and catch them and toss them back and forth, and you know they do all this wild crazy stuff, and the mom's over here like, oh. Right. Now, and I distinctly remember as a little girl, my two older brothers doing this with us. My two older brothers picking up our baby sister. There's 20-year age difference between the oldest and the youngest in our family. Two older brothers picking up the baby, tossing her back and forth to each other. And we thought this was the greatest thing ever. And our mom is like, you know, hiding her eyes. And I thought, oh, mom, come on, we're just having fun. Well, then I had babies. And then I'm like, ah! You know, this whole thing just comes roaring out of you, right? That the paternal instinct, these are different things and they play out differently. Each of these things is important. Each of these things matter. I talked in the last time about the child's need for the bond with the mother in the early years. As the child grows older, their relationship with their father becomes more and more important. Because why? The father is escorting the baby out of the house and into the adult world and helping them make sense of that world. And what does the father do? The father provides and protects. What does the father do? He is capable of heroic loyalty. Men get beat up because they're not just girls, because you think and feel differently than women do. But the fact is that what men do is something that needs to be done. And most men are capable of heroic loyalty, throwing themselves on a live grenade. Who does that? Guys do that. Who runs into a burning building? Guys do that. And by undermining manhood, we have left a big gap in society, and guess who marches right into that gap? The provide and protect gap. Who marches into that? The state. The state marches into that gap. And that's why getting the fathers out of the house, getting the fathers off the playing field, neutralizing men in the whole debate over gender issues, neutralizing men, telling men they can't even show up in the classes, right? Some of your gender studies classes, all women. This is a huge strategic advantage that the revolutionaries gained by getting you guys off the playing field. Because now, us girls with our babies, I'm not helpless now. You're not helpless now. But when you're a nursing mother, you're helpless. You're pretty darn helpless. You need somebody to help you. We're sitting ducks when the men are out of the home, when the men are out of the family, when the men can't even be part of the discussion. So this degendering thing's been going on a long time, and it's very destructive, in my opinion. And the transgender issue is just the final manifestation of that thing. Final one I put down here, the little boys are expected to be sit still in school. Okay, come on. Come on. Little boys don't behave. We drug them. We drug them so that the little boys can act like little girls. That's not right. All right. Now, I want to point out, I have not said a single thing about same-sex attraction, gay marriage, or anything else. And there's a reason why I did this. This is a strategic decision on my part. I wanted to focus my whole argument and my whole attention on children and not adults, on the needs of children and not adults. Those issues transcend gayness or straightness, right? I haven't singled anybody out. I'm not picking on anybody. The fact is, the standard that I put up there at the end of the last hour, the kids have relational rights and identity rights, that standard, pretty much everybody in society is a sinner by that standard, right? I know I am. I know I am, right? But that's okay. We have to face it so we can deal with it, right? But so we're not singling out gay people. And honestly, I think it's not possible to say we're going to defend the family, but we're okay with the sexual revolution. We just don't like the gay parts. Not going to fly. That's not going to fly. And we're not making excuses. Say, we're not making excuses for the wider society while focusing all our attention on what same-sex attracted persons do or don't do. Okay? And because it's not fair. It's not fair to be doing that. Now, I do think, though, you can see that the argument in favor of genderless marriage, as I call it, same-sex marriage that has no gender requirement, so that two men, two women, one of each, those are all treated the same thing under law. I think you can see that to believe that that's a thing, you have to already have believed the whole sexual revolution. You have to already believe that sterile sex is a possibility, right, and is not particularly socially significant, because gay sex is kind of the ultimate in sterile sex. You have to believe that children don't really need their own mothers and fathers, but actually they do. Right? And you have to believe that gender isn't really a thing, right? That gender isn't really important, and that you can construct and reconstruct the body and the self and your sense of what it means to be a man or a woman. Well, if you already believe those three things, the gender ideology, the contraceptive ideology, the divorce ideology, if you already believe those three things, in your mind, you've already redefined marriage. Right? And so that, I believe, is why the culture can't understand why we're holding out. Because in their minds, they've already redefined marriage. And they already believe those three things, and they can't work out what is our problem. Why don't we get on board? Why don't we get with the program? The reason we don't is because we don't believe that any of these things are true. The sexual revolution is irrational. It's impossible. You cannot build a whole society around the idea that sex doesn't make babies, even though sex doesn't make babies every single time. Duh, I know that. But the idea that you can build a society around the idea that it never makes babies is great. Well, sex is a sterile activity. Reproduction is just kind of thrown in as an afterthought. In case you happen to have quirky lifestyle preferences, you can use sex to have a baby. Although why you would want to do that, I don't know, when you can get a perfect designer baby by going to the whatever store. Anyway, so kids really, truly do need their own mothers and fathers. The divorce ideology is utterly false, completely false, inhumanly false. And men and women actually really and truly are different. So it is not possible to create this fantasy world that the revolutionaries want to create. It is not possible. It's irrational. It's impossible. It cannot stand on its own two feet. The natural family reproduces itself and reinforces itself. You know, you come home, you're living with a person of the opposite sex, you see very quickly that men and women are different, you know, and you see very quickly that children need their mothers and fathers. And you might even discover that sex makes babies. So, but the contrary ideology has to be continually reinforced. It has to be, it requires force, and it requires a lot of propaganda. And if you ever feel like you're overwhelmed with propaganda, one more stupid study, one more TV show saying the kids are all right and the father's a buffoon, or whatever it is, one more movie that makes a joke out of donor conception, whatever it is, you're correct. You are being flooded with propaganda. You are being flooded with propaganda. All of us are. Because that's the only way they can keep this thing going. That is why the religious liberty issue turns out to be so crucial. They've got to crush those little sisters of the poor. Doggone it, you cannot have these little sisters out there saying, we're not going to pay for contraception. Sorry. No, they cannot be allowed to do that. You cannot allow this nurse in, what was it, Sweden? This nurse in Sweden, a midwife in Sweden, refused to be involved with abortions. And she was told that she was wrong and she would have to participate in abortions. She's gone to Finland to get a job. But you cannot allow dissent. You see, that's what's important about all these cases. That's what's important about all these, the struggle over whether there's going to be conscience rights, all right? Because you have to crush these people who are raising their hands saying, but wait, the emperor has no clothes. No, you can't allow that. And there are just too many of these things where it pops up that people are going to be objecting and digressing and saying, no, I don't agree, I don't go along with it. So that's what's required. To keep it going is force and propaganda. The state is necessarily involved in keeping this thing together. It is a pagan ideology that no Christian should have anything to do with. And we have let much too much go by. We have allowed too many things to go by with the idea that it's not that big a deal. Oh, it's not that big a deal. It'll be okay. Whatever. Now, I say that all the time. It's a pagan ideology no Christian should have anything to do with. Well, after one of my talks, a guy comes up to me and he says, Dr. Morris, I think you're being too tough on the pagans. Oh, what do you mean? And he said, well, you know, Aristotle and Greek philosophers and so on and so forth, they wouldn't have had any of these problems. You know, they were noble pagans and they understood the difference. You know, they understood natural law. They understood natural reality. They had respect for what is, right? And I said, well, yeah, I guess that's true. I don't think the Greeks back when they were having their Olympics would have ever wondered whether the decathlon winner was a male or a woman, male or female. You know, I mean, I think they would have had that worked out. So I believe that it's proper to say that it is a totalitarian ideology. The sexual revolution is a totalitarian ideology that no Christian should have anything to do with. And all of these issues, every single one of these issues, has to do with separating people that are naturally connected to each other. The divorce ideology has the state coming into the family and coming between a married couple and their marriage bonds. People don't realize that the no-fault divorce world, what it really means is that one person can end the marriage for any reason or no reason. It doesn't really mean that two sensible adult people get together and sit down and resolve their differences amicably, and why should the state force them to stay together? That's not really what it means. What it really means is that the state will take sides with the person who wants the marriage the least. That's what it means. All right, so the state is separating people. Donor conception. Donor conception would not be a thing at all without the state. Why? Because when people use an anonymous sperm donor, anonymous egg donor, something like that, what they want is not just the baby, but they want the undisputed right to be the parent of that baby, which means that the donor has to be kept away. The donor has to be kept out of the picture. Only the government can do that. Only the government can say, you masturbated into a jar and sold it, you're not the father anymore, you have no parental rights. So the state is necessarily involved in all of this, and all of the things they're involved with have to do with separating people from each other. What are some of the motives for the sexual revolution? I believe that there are plenty of people who are making money off of this thing. My friend Sue Ellen Browder wrote this book called Subverted, which I recommend to you. She was a writer for Cosmo, back in the day, Cosmo Girl. And she will tell you, in this book, she tells, the image of the Cosmo Girl, of the sex and the single girl, the career woman who makes lots of money and has a glamorous lifestyle, that was all invented in order to sell expensive vacations, expensive perfumes, and all of these things that the Cosmo Girl would need in order to keep up this image. And they made up stuff. I mean, it was literally commercial. Commercially motivated. It looks like an ideology, but actually there's money making behind it. The fact is that what the sexual revolution has done is to accumulate power within the state and the people who control the state. The state has unprecedented power over people's private lives now that they would never have had any other way. We're isolated, we're sitting ducks, and people who can't control themselves end up being controlled by others. You may know a few of the alpha males who have financed the sexual revolution, but then again, you may not realize it. You may not realize George Soros has put millions, probably billions of dollars, into various kinds of organizations that promote family breakdown in one form or another. Warren Buffett has put in over $1 billion of his own money to promote abortion. Now think about that. One guy has pumped all that money into not just paying for people's abortions privately, but for changing the law, that everybody has to live under. So there's a lot of big money from a handful of very wealthy people that have gone into this. Now, how many victims are there to the sexual revolution? The contraceptive ideology, I estimate that if a million abortions take place every year and only 10% of them are traumatized, that's still 100,000 women per year, every year since 1973, walking around with untreated or undertreated trauma. That's a lot of people to be blowing off year after year after year. The divorce ideology, about a million children per year, every year since 1972, have been separated from their parents due to divorce. That's a lot of kids. The gender ideology, heartbroken career women, the women who have it all except they can't have any kids. I've estimated that about 500,000 women with advanced degrees experience impaired fertility. And then there are many other categories that we have no idea how many people have been harmed by it because we don't even keep the data. So the reluctantly divorced people, that's a term we invented, reluctantly divorced, that's a person who wanted to stay married. We don't even ask the questions that would allow us to know how many people. On that chart that I gave you, there are many of those people, we have no idea how many they are because nobody, they're completely socially invisible. That's a point. That's a point to see. So I ask you, hasn't this gone on long enough? Isn't it time somebody did something about it? We really believe that it is. So what are we going to do about it? Here's the Ruth Institute goal. Ruth Institute goal is to create a Christ-like social movement to deal with the family, with the problems of family breakdown. Now that's the tame corporate version. I want to end the agony and the injustice of family breakdown, and I want to do it in a Christ-like way. Now, healing the culture in a Christ-like way, I've got this picture. Some of you will recognize this picture. Who is this guy? Who is this hipster? That's Pope John Paul II as a young man, as a young priest, okay? So this is our hipster, cool Pope here. He said at one point, if we do not win through love, the evil will return in a different form. He said that when Poland was under Nazi occupation. They did get rid of the Nazis, and then what happened? Communists came in, okay? So we need to win through love or the thing isn't going to work in the first place. So what can you do about it? What can you do right now? Okay, I want you to go back to that little list I had you make of your three difficult relatives. Your three difficult relatives, you got them there? Here's what I want you to do, and don't take all day. I want you to think of one endearing trait of one of those people. You got it? One endearing trait of one of those difficult people. You don't have to write it down, just have it in your mind. Now turn to the person next to you and tell them what it is. I'm not kidding. Do it. Just tell them. What is it? What is the one endearing trait? Person. Okay, guys. You did it, right? You did it. All right. Listen to me. Listen to me. You guys, you just helped the family. You just helped the family. Why? First of all, you recognize that even difficult people have something of value to offer. And you saw around the room, every family has difficult family members, right? You're not the only one with crazy relatives. We all have them, okay? And we have choices about what we're going to do with our difficult relatives. You can focus on their endearing qualities, or you can sit there and kvetch all day about how awful they are. Right? We all have those choices. This is one of the things we talk about at our Healing Family Breakdown Retreat, which is one of the Ruth Institute big programs that we're doing now, to try to help people heal from all this craziness that has been going on around us. I just want to call attention to this slogan, the personal is political. Have you ever heard that? Is that still a thing, the personal is political? Okay, well, whether you've heard of it or not, it used to be a thing. And the radical feminists, what they meant to say by that, which they did not say, what they meant to say was, we intend to politicize every single aspect of your personal life. That's what they mean to say, and they have largely succeeded. I want you to see how much they've succeeded. And so what we need to understand as Christians and as Christian advocates is that the ancient teachings of Christianity, the teachings that we all share, no matter what our denominational background, they are being undermined, not necessarily by superior intellectual argument, because I'm telling you, intellectually, this thing's a house of cards. It's being undermined at the personal level, where nobody wants to hurt mom's feelings, nobody wants to say anything because everybody's a sinner, you know, whatever. Have you ever heard the expression, God writes straight with crooked lines? Anybody ever heard that expression? It's a paraphrase of all things work together for good for those who love the Lord, okay? No matter what screwed up, messed up, terrible thing you may have done or may have happened to you, God can make something good out of that. So now look around at our culture, how much messed up craziness we've got going. If we would really let God write straight with all those broken lines, we would be the holiest place ever. Right, because he's got so much to work with. So what we are trying to do, what we're trying to say, what we're trying to advocate is that we face up to whatever these issues might be in our own lives and deal with them head on, and that we become sources of healing for others. One way you can help others is if you've got a story to tell, tell your story. We've got a special blog at the Ruth Institute called Tell Your Story, Tell Ruth the Truth, it's called, and people write in with all kinds of stuff that they've done, that they regret, or things that were done to them that they're trying to deal with, and so on. And this is important. I think it's important because everybody thinks that I'm the only one who's having these problems. If only me and my family were more together, none of this would be happening. You know, it shouldn't bother me that my boyfriend hasn't called me up. It shouldn't bother me that my parents are divorced. We shouldn't be having all these step-parent problems. No, everybody's having these problems, and we're all isolated. See, and that's a trick of the enemy, is to keep us isolated so we don't ask any questions and we don't make any progress. Most women who come for abortions were contracepting. I put that down. That's a very interesting example. What do the advocates always like to say? They always like to say, contraception, if used correctly every time, is failure rate, right? I mean, that's what if used correctly every time. So, do you know, around half of the women who come for abortions claim that they were using contraception in the previous month. Now, and so how do they feel? They feel like, I obviously didn't use it correctly. Must be my fault. Come on, 50%? I mean, you know, it's her fault. Now it's her fault. In her mind, it's her fault, and she's isolated, and she's alone. But the fact is, there's something wrong with the whole approach, the whole structure. There's something wrong. You don't tell people, go screw around with anybody you feel like it, because it'll be safe. No, that's not right, okay? But that is what people are being told. So we want people to be survivors, not victims. That's why we put that word survivors in that pamphlet, because decent people don't want to be victims forever, and we want to make a difference, and we want you to be part of making a difference. Above all these, put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. Thanks very much. I hope you've all signed up on the Ruth Institute sign-up sheet so that we can meet again and do something to put an end to the agony and injustice of family breakdown. Thank you.
You've just been listening to Dr. J speaking on the sexual revolution and its victims to a class of law students as part of the Alliance Defending Freedom's Blackstone Legal Fellowship. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org. And we're also on Facebook, like the Ruth Institute or Dr. Jennifer Roback Moore's pages for updates. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.org and iTunes, and as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization devoted to bringing hope and encouragement for lifelong married love and healing within the family.